Welcome back to Postcards from Home. I'm your host, Erick Gill, and I'm joined once again by Sandra Bogan at the Oxbow Eco Center. Cindy, these aren't really live animals,
no.
but these are some animals that you might be able to see if you walk the trails.
Right. This is a model of a gopher tortoise.
Okay.
And as this is a tortoise, is a land turtle versus he's not much of a swimmer. It's kind of heavy.
Yes.
I've been walking around since the days of the dinosaurs. Kind of looks like he has elephant feet on his back legs, and of course he looks like a sea turtle from the front. So he digs a hole called a burrow. This is his burrow.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the number went to over 400 species of animals have been found to use the gopher tortoise burrow.
Huh.
That's where the hurricane party happens. That's where if a wildfire hits, that's where all the little animals go.
Okay.
You have a couple of features down here. Mm-hmm. You have the indigo snake who uses the burrow. You have the Florida mouse, which is a threatened species in Florida. And you have the gopher frog, which obviously got its name from his good friend, the gopher tortoise. So he's called the landlord of the uplands.
Okay.
Like uplands.
And you've got a few of those on the property?
We have quite a few of those on the property. In fact, carrying capacity is full. People try to bring the oxbow animals, including gopher tortoises and squirrels. But with gopher tortoises, once they have established their territory, you bring a new person in, you bring a new gopher tortoise in, and you'll start having territorial fights, and they actually fight to the death. So the good citizen, who thought he was doing the right thing by bringing a gopher tortoise here, just killed one or the other of the gopher tortoises. So you just have to remember, although this seems like a big piece of property, it's tiny. And it has a certain carrying capacity when it comes to animals.
Well, speaking of live animals, you've got a new addition.
I do. I want you to meet Ollie.
Okay, let's
go. Okay.
All right, Sandy, what do we got in here? A little kitty cat?
No, not a kitty cat. This is a fairly new addition. This is Ollie the Awesome Opossum. She loves this little ball, Erick, found for her. And I'm going to pull her out. Ollie came to us.
I'll let you do that. I'm not reaching into a hole unless there's a lobster in there.
She's a sweet little girl. Yeah. Sorry if my voice changes as I talk about the possum. She came to us as a little orphaned baby. We don't really know what happened to her mom. But she had some issues when she was younger. Possums should stay wild, if at all possible. So despite the fact that I'm holding her and she's my sweet little baby, it's hard to keep them healthy. They need a certain amount of calcium.
She looks pretty healthy.
She's pretty healthy. If I put her down, you'd see she limps around, and she's not that strong. And if you look at her face, mm-hmm. Her jaws grew crookedly, so she kind of has a crooked smile, I tell the kids anyway. Isn't she cute? But do you know what kind of animal possums are?
Nocturnal animals?
Nocturnal, that's a very good word
for
the
day. So we're waking her up? Are they don't they have the pouches,
too? They have the pouch. I can show you the pouch. She's a girl.
Yeah, yes.
So there's the pouch. And so then, therefore, they are?
Marsupials?
Marsupials.
Yes,
like
look at
the
that.
Kangaroo. The star student for the day.
They got a sticker.
They don't have great eyesight and they don't have great hearing. But the one thing they do, that's what she said, what they do have is a great sense of smell. So that's really one of their best strategies for survival. But just like the gopher tortoise, they've actually been around since dinosaurs as well.
Really?
And you wouldn't think.
No.
An animal that doesn't really have a huge brain. Can't see very well, can't hear very well, and plays dead when threatened, would
survive.
Be the one to survive when all these other animals went extinct. But apparently, gentleness might have its, advantages.
Yes. So says Darwinism, right?
Would you like to help me feed her?
I would love to help you feed her.
You would.
As long as she doesn't eat my fingers.
She won't. Actually, and she just likes to feel secure.
You see
how I have her back leg.
Like football carry?
Yeah. Okay. And we're going to feed her a cricket, and I'm actually going to hand feed her. It's one of her favorite foods. But she probably would not have made it in the wild, because when we first got her, she didn't even play dead.
Can she smell that already?
She can smell that already.
Nose going.
This is a little cricket.
Look at that.
And
whoa, look at that.
Oh, there she goes. Yum, yum, yum. Did you know we fed
chocolate covered?
Did you know we fed our summer camp kids chocolate covered crickets?
Did you really?
Yeah.
Awesome.
I think they all partook.
Is that good?
Yeah. Now she's awake.
Look at that.
Darn.
Two for three.
Yeah. Very good.
Well, he's still down on the ground. We can probably get that one.
Right.
He's not going anywhere. Oh, now he's moving.
Look at him.
There we go.
Would you get it in your mouth? There.
She got it that time.
So she, you know, they're omnivores, which means
they eat anything.
Anything. Not her, really. She's sort of a special case, but possums in general are omnivores.
Look at that tail, and the tail is like a monkey tail.
It's like a monkey tail. Now, you know, people think they hang from their tails.
They don't.
Only when they're teensy-tiny, yes. Yes, it would disjoint their tail, but they definitely use it when going downhill or when they feel insecure. What else should I tell them about you, Miss Ollie? Not much, just that you're happy at the Oxbow. Come visit me.
Well, and you've got other animals, too, that have been here a while. Godzilla is one of my favorites.
Yeah, a lot of people's favorite, actually. We can take a walk over there. And
well, Sandy, I think this is one of my kids' favorite, because Godzilla. And it looks like he's lost a little weight.
Yeah, thanks for noticing. He's our wise old man of our group of animals. He's actually about 30 years old.
Wow.
He was a little kid's turtle, pet turtle, and the kid grew up, went to college, graduated from college. Mama has the turtle, and then Mama gave him to us after deciding to go live on a boat.
Now, and these guys look new, too, since the last time I was here, these peninsula cooters.
Yeah, right.
So in fact, when I first got here, this one was doing a little Tai Chi or yoga pose.
Right.
He had one leg out and one.
He's been watching us.
He has.
It was so cute. He was on that rock just like.
Balanced, I know.
And then this one's a soft shell. So you know how big soft shells get. I mean, they get, I don't know, bigger than a dinner plate, bigger than a platter.
Yeah.
They get giant. So this is a little guy. And then the peninsula cougar
is
hiding.
He's in the back.
Yes, right. They're all really great at helping us to teach kids about turtles. I mean, a lot of kids, really because of the cartoons, think that turtles like change shells, like hermit crabs, and can take their shell off and twirl it around.
Yeah.
But the truth is, they have a backbone, and it's connected to the shell. We have a couple other turtles. Box turtles, which are less
land.
Aquatic and more land turtles.
Well, we're getting short on time, but before we do, the guy over there, I think, was splashing because he wants some camera time.
Yay.
You got a new, it looks like an eel, but it's not.
That's right.
Should we go over there and check him out?
Sure, let's do it.
All right, well, Sandy, this guy behind us was making a lot of noise before. Or is it a girl?
Well, it's a girl.
All the animals here are female.
No, that's not true.
No, it's not true? Okay.
No.
But it looks like a snake or an eel, but it's actually in the salamander family.
It is.
Yes?
It's actually a siren.
Mm-hmm. You see he's got the two little legs up front.
Only two legs, and she uses them all the time to get around. She normally will live in our freshwater canals. And at first you're like, ooh, you're not too pretty. But the more you look at her, she has sort of a leopard pattern. And she's really rather beautiful. And she's very graceful as she swims. But when she wants your attention, she gets it.
Speaking of pretty, let's talk about this pretty thing.
Well, not so pretty. I mean, if he was in his own land.
Touch him. I'm not going to get warts if I touch him.
No, that's fake.
He's real.
If he was in his own land, he might be beautiful because he does have this beautiful belly.
Yes.
With the sort of leopard pattern, too. He's really mad at me right now, so he's all puffed
up.
Yes. Trying to look big. But this is actually the Bufo marinus, also known as the cane toad. This is the one everybody should worry about when their animal, if the dog is playing with a toad and has it in its mouth. Here's his two glands. And that's where it releases that toxic, milky substance that will actually kill a cat. So they're exotics. They don't belong here. I can't really tell you. They probably came over like during shipments and transportation. I don't think anybody released, you know, cane toads for any good reason. But I wanted to show you one little trick with a cane toad.
Yes. How do you euthanize them?
Yeah. A lot of people are doing it because he is an exotic. Yes. And they put him in their, you know, their freezer, and they just slowly, you know, freeze. Yeah, that's enough, buddy. So, and look how small he got now. He's going to get bigger.
Look at that.
Yeah. But you notice that he has no neck. No neck. And of course, with our necks and our throats, that's how we chew and mm-hmm. swallow our food. Well, the way a cane toad chews and swallows his food is he actually uses his eyeballs. His eyeballs go in and help him to push the food down. So if you'll see, if I close his eyeballs, uh-huh. it's completely flat, and then they'll just pop up. So that is how a cane toad chews and gets the food down. Pretty cool, huh?
Pretty cool.
Yeah. But you would know automatically that this is not a native just by its size.
Yeah.
You know, a Florida native is not going to be this big at all, not even close. Frogs are even smaller.
Yeah. I mean, speaking of non-natives, you mentioned you don't know how they got released, but a lot of it is us. People, you know, I bought this as a pet and he was this big, but now he's, you know, this long, he didn't fit in the cage anymore. Well, I'm going to go dump him in the canal.
Right.
That's the wrong thing to do.
Which is wreaking havoc right now in the Everglades with pythons. Snakes are a big one. They reproduce a lot. They eat
a lot.
What have they found? They found deer inside them. They just don't belong in this habitat.
Sure.
But people just need to be more responsible. There's somebody that'll take that, you know, giant snake off your hands. Putting him out in nature. I mean, if you look at him, he's going to outcompete our natives. Same with
he's
the Cuban tree
me.
Frog. So people just need to be more responsible. If they don't know what to do with their animal, you know, they can give us a call and we can try to help find them a home.
Other than here, because you guys are pre-booked.
Yeah.
No room at the end, at the outset.
No. But we have some contacts, so
yeah. Nice
we can help
you,
out. It's just really important, though, for...
Take it easy.
Nice to meet you, Eric.
It's funny, when you hold him, he looks rubber, and then, you know, you see... Yeah, that's a little too close. I remember as a kid, my dad used to, we used to catch salamanders, so he'd use them as bait. But he used to always keep your mouth shut, because if you keep your mouth open, they'll jump down your throat and choke you to death. So reptiles kind of freaked me out. But.
Yeah, I can see that.
Well, Sandy, I appreciate you taking the time. But I just have to shake left hand here, and thank you, sir. Does this guy have a name?
What is your name? I forget your name. Oh. Colonel Sanders.
Colonel Sanders. Take a Frog Leg Festival. Sign him up.
He's got nice legs. Yeah.
All right. Well, all right. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Nice to see you. Come back soon.
I will. If you want to experience what Florida was like before four-lane highways and strip malls, be sure to visit the Oxbow Eco Center. Located at 5400 Northeast St. James Drive in Port St. Lucie, the Oxbow's 3 miles of trails are open 7 days a week from dawn until dusk. The Education Center is open Tuesdays through Fridays from noon to 5 p.m. and Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Feel free to just drop in and check out their nature exhibits or sign up for one of the many environmental education programs such as lectures, guided hikes, story times, and art and nature programs. Now, to find out more information about the Oxbow's monthly programs, call the staff at 785-5833, that's 785-5833, or visit their website at oxboweco.com. If you'd like to see previously aired episodes of Postcards from Home, visit our website at stlucieco.gov/slctv and click on the video on demand link. I'm your host, Erick Gill. Thanks for watching. We hope you'll tune in again next month as we continue to send out Postcards from Home.